Yeah, thank you. So thanks for staying around until the last talk of the meeting. This is going to be a very short description of one result, so I won't take too much of your time. I'm going to talk about reionization, and I'll present a result about the structure of the Lyman-alpha forest at the end of the epoch of reionization. And this result was developed in collaboration with several people who are listed here. So we have heard several talks on reionization through the day today. Just to put everything on the same page, the two governing questions in research on reionization are when did reionization happen and what caused it? So in today's talk, I'm going to talk about the first of these questions. I'll describe a model that explains the structure of the Lyman-alpha forest towards redshift 6 particularly well, and I will argue that that model has implications for when reionization happened. Okay? So now, there are several astrophysical probes of the duration and redshift of reionization. Many of us might know what these are. The prominent among these are the CMB that measures the integrated Thomson scattering opacity of the IGM, Lyman-alpha absorption in spectra of background objects by residual neutral hydrogen is another probe. There's Lyman-alpha emission from galaxies that can also probe the structure of the intergalactic medium. And famously, 21 centimeter absorption and emission that we heard about from Shiv's talk earlier in this session. So this plot that I have taken from the Planck 2016 paper tries to explain one thing about these probes, which is that if I plot the ionized hydrogen fraction of the universe as a function of redshift, then the CMB and the Lyman-alpha forest provide sort of boundary conditions on the models of reionization. Because the Thomson scattering opacity of post-reionization universe is very high, although the CMB measures an integrated quantity, the effect is that it pushes reionization to lower and lower redshift. And because Lyman-alpha forest experiment can only operate at lower redshift, thanks to various reasons, Lyman-alpha forest pushes it to higher and higher redshift. So Lyman-alpha and CMB are the two main channels with which we can constrain the redshift of reionization. And the goal is to make this plot as robust and as model independent as possible. You notice that there are several limits on this. So the for people who do not think about the Lyman-alpha forest in their day-to-day research, this is a quick introduction because we haven't heard about this in detail in today's talks. So keeping the CMB part of observables aside, if you focus on Lyman-alpha forest, the idea is very simple. You find a bright object, typically quasars are ideal for this purpose, at a distance from us and take a good spectra of these objects with a terrestrial telescope. And thanks to the expansion of the universe, different frequencies in the spectrum of this quasar are going to encounter neutral hydrogen at different locations along the sight line. And if there is neutral hydrogen along the sight line, that will create a Lyman-alpha absorption feature if certain conditions are met. So this is an example of the Lyman-alpha forest in a quasar spectrum where the quasar is located at redshift 3.62. There are some familiar features. There's this continuum spectrum of the quasar. There's an intrinsic Lyman-alpha emission line, and bluewards of that, you see this dense forest of absorption lines. This is how Lyman-alpha forest looks like, and if you resolve these individual lines, you can measure the ionization and thermal state of the material along this. So that is how you push reionization from the low redshift end, right? Now, it is very well known that the structure of the Lyman-alpha forest evolves with redshift. And these two quasars already serve as an example. This one's at redshift 0.158. This one's at redshift 3.62. Very different redshift. The overall continuum spectrum looks remarkably similar, but the Lyman-alpha forest is very different. You see dense network of absorption lines here. You see virtually complete transmission here. Now, what was realized in the last 3 or 4 years is that not only does Lyman-alpha forest structure evolve in redshift, it also seems to evolve in space at a fixed redshift. So there are these spatial fluctuations in the Lyman-alpha forest, and this pair of quasar absorption spectra serve as an example of that. What is shown here are two chunks of Lyman-alpha forest spectra from two quasars at redshift 6. And you see that they're remarkably different. These quasars are located at the same redshift. The spectrum shown in red here, the bottom one, is almost completely wiped out. There is a large Gunn-Peterson trough of 160 megaparsecs. But at the same redshift, the intergalactic medium at a different location on the sky seem to have significant transmission. Okay, now just for the purpose of doing some quantitative science, one would like to quantify this. And one way that is traditionally done is to take the average transmission in chunks of 50 co-moving megaparsecs over H in these Lyman-alpha forest spectra, and then define something called the effective opacity as the negative logarithm of that quantity. So now the fact that Lyman-alpha forest shows spatial fluctuations can be recast as the statement that the effective opacity shows a scatter at a fixed redshift. And so this is a plot that illustrates this. What is shown in the vertical axis is this effective opacity in the redshift range of 4 to 6. And you see that towards the low redshift end of this interval, these points are pretty closely bunched together. But as you go to higher and higher redshifts, they fan out in a large scatter, so that the scatter in the mean transmission here is about factor of 2, but it's about factor of 500 here. Okay. So this is the puzzle. There is a large scatter in Lyman-alpha forest effective opacity, especially towards the higher redshift end of the data. Now, spatial fluctuations in themselves are not necessarily surprising. We do expect some spatial fluctuations because the universe is not perfectly homogeneous. It is only statistically homogeneous. We have density fluctuations, and this is a slice from a simulation at redshift 5.76, roughly the same redshift at which I showed data. But what's interesting is that these density fluctuations do not explain the Lyman-alpha opacity fluctuations that I showed on the previous slide. And so this plot now illustrates this. What is shown here is the same result in a different way. In four redshift bins, what has been plotted by these people here is the cumulative distribution function of the same quantity, this effective Lyman-alpha opacity, where the jagged lines here are the data. So you see this spread apart. That's the scatter we are talking about, particularly at high redshift, it's very easily noticeable. And these dashed lines with a shaded region are what you expect from density fluctuations alone, and there's no way you can explain these high tau effective values using density fluctuations. One can begin investigating this problem by first noting that the opacity, this tau effective, is related to the temperature, density, and the photoionization rate. Okay. The density and photoionization rate dependence is sort of obvious because of ionization equilibrium, but the temperature is slightly less obvious, and it turns out that it comes from the recombination rate. Okay. So immediately, once this problem was noted in 2015, models came out which first noted that the density fluctuations don't help in explaining the tau fluctuations. So let's try explaining them by fluctuations in temperature and photoionization rate. It so happened that both of these models had issues. The temperature fluctuation models required very high temperatures, and the photoionization rate fluctuations required too low mean free paths. I don't have time to go into the details of these very good attempts at explaining these, but just take it from me that they required somewhat unrealistic assumptions to get these curves. There was a third line of effort in the literature where people came up with clustered sources instead of these fluctuations. They said that the sources that ionize the universe are very highly clustered. So instead of galaxies, they are quasars, which are much more clustered, and that can produce these. And that has its own issues, namely quasars might not exist in sufficient numbers. So what we had been doing while these results were coming out was we were developing these reionization simulations. Reionization is a difficult problem. One requires numerics to solve that, and even then it's not easy. So we have been using something called the M1 method of doing radiative transfer, and we use GPUs to speed these up. And thanks to these innovations, what we have managed to achieve is simulations that have the highest dynamic range on the planet. Which probe somewhere around 80 kiloparsecs to 320 megaparsecs. So this is a video of how reionization occurs in one of these simulations, where this panel shows the evolution of the ionized the neutral fraction, and here it shows the temperature. I'll come back to something interesting about these panels soon. This is just to show you how these simulations look like, and also to note another quick thing, which is that the bubble size at the beginning of the reionization process were very small, which is to say that the reionization here is initiated by galaxies, by quasars. Right, so what happens to this Lyman-alpha puzzle? We found that these simulations failed to explain the tau-effective PDFs, and so we thought we were making just the same mistakes, but this time, because these simulations were bigger, much bigger than the mean free path of a ionizing photon, we thought this was an interesting result, that even in such big volumes, you don't see as high amount of fluctuation as in the data. So this panel illustrates that. This is showing that the mean free path in our simulations is consistent with the observations, and the box size is bigger than the mean free path at relevant redshifts. But then we realized that the simulations, and all simulations that have been done of reionization in the last two decades or so, are calibrated to the measured photoionization rate from the Lyman-alpha forest. That is what we had done as well, and we were very proud that we could do that in these simulations. But then the photoionization rate is not an observed quantity. It's a derived quantity, and it is a model-dependent quantity. And therefore, we realized what needed to be done was to calibrate the simulation differently. We should have calibrated the simulations to an observed quantity, namely the quantity we are after, the mean flux. So here again, I show a plot where the left panel is the effective opacity cluster plot that I showed a while back. And here again are those distributions. This time I'm splitting the lower limits as optimistic and pessimistic, where the lower limits are treated as detections or a completely infinite opacity system, okay? And then once we calibrated them to the mean flux that was observed, instead of the photoionization rate, we found that the simulation matched these data perfectly. Okay? So you can see that even the distributions are reproduced in these models. In fact, we can go further now and predict how these distributions will look like in higher redshift bins. And we have been now awarded about 113 hours on VLT to target 29 high redshift quasars, where we are aiming to do Lyman-alpha and Lyman-beta studies to make this picture a bit more confident. Right. So here is a model which solves the puzzle of why Lyman-alpha has a lot of spatial fluctuations. So what does this tell us about epoch of reionization? So let me just say that and then finish. Here are light cones of the neutral hydrogen fraction, the temperature, and the photoionization rate in this model. The first thing we note is that the reionization is really late. The midpoint of the reionization is 7.5, and that turns out to be critical because here reionization is ending well below 5.5 in redshift. It creates these long neutral islands in the intergalactic medium, which is what is needed to explain these tails in the opacity distribution. Another interesting thing to note is that this widely used temperature density relationship of the IGM never exists. We find ubiquitous temperature fluctuations all the way down to redshift 5, and actually even lower because of helium reionization down to redshift 2. So that's the first result, that here is a model of late reionization. We learn that reionization ended much below redshift 5.5, and we learn that there were temperature fluctuations. I will just mention that it turns out that this result seems to be concordant. It matches with many other things we have been learning about reionization, and suddenly everything makes sense now. So for example, the Planck 2018 measurement of the tau falls right on top of the value in this model, okay? The damping wing analysis from redshift 7.5 quasars fall right on top of the evolution of the neutral hydrogen fraction. The dark pixel analysis, that too agrees with this model, okay? I'll just skip work we have done on Lyman-alpha emission, and then in the interest of time, I'll just conclude. All I want you to take away is that we are now very confident about having understood the second half of reionization. We think that reionization is late. It ends at 5.2, 5.3. The midpoint is at 7.5. It is consistent with being caused by galaxies and consistent with many other constraints we have on reionization. So I'll stop there. Thanks.
Thank you very much. Questions?
I agree with you that always you have to match the observable, not the derived quantity. But there is a problem in doing that, because to match the observable, mm-hmm. in your model, either you could tweak gamma H1 or you could tweak the thermal history. So I presume that you have just changed the gamma, right?
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, so we have tuned gamma. You'll notice that I didn't say much about thermal history at all here.
Yeah, yeah.
The problem is thermal history constraints are also, there are two problems. One is thermal history constraints, the measurements of T0 are model dependent. The second is these are post-processed simulation. So it's difficult at this moment to...
So I think while I'm happy with the statement that reionization can end up to 5.1, 5.2, I think this equation of statement require confirmation, because you have to run a model. See, suppose you say that you get the best fit gamma H1 now.
Yeah.
Can you go back and rerun the model for that gamma H1 and reproduce your thermal history?
No, I think the...
So that's how you have to do, right?
Mm. Yeah. No, but I think, yeah, that's absolutely... So we have done some work. We haven't been sitting idle. So we have made some progress in that direction. So I agree with you. But I would, though, suggest that the idea that fluctuations exist, that a simple power law doesn't exist in phase space, seems to be well understood now. And I think that will continue to exist even when these simulations are calibrated to temperature. And it simply happens because of different cooling times in different
densities. We discussed before. Mm. I think once you ionize the thing, cooling is dominated by expansion.
Mm.
The only way I can understand is that at different patches of your thing start expanding freely after some time, right? In the sense of cooling, adiabatic cooling starts after some time.
Mm.
So in that patch, you will have an equation of state. So the question is like, what do you mean by equation of state at what scales? Like you ask somebody else also. In these cases, we have to be very careful, right? So there will be a scale-dependent statement, I think. That's what I meant.
Yeah, that's an interesting point, yeah. Yeah, okay.
Any final quick questions? Okay, with that, let's thank the speaker.